You know how you can tell that I'm the boss here at Art of Problem Solving? You can tell I'm the boss because I have the most keys. This one's for the studio. Had to use that to get up here today. This one's for the main office. Got a couple different post office box keys. One for the company, one for the foundation. Have a whole lot of storage keys for the storage place where we keep our most excellent textbooks. Let's see, then there's, oh. I don't know what this key is. If you know what this key is, shoot me an email and let me know. Oh, this is my favorite key right here. That's my favorite key. See that key? You don't see the whole key because, see, this key was acting up. So I snapped it just like that. But I left it on the keychain as a message to all the other keys to make sure that they wouldn't act up too. Yeah, I have a whole lot of keys here. This isn't the only way I had to put them on. The keychain, though, I could put them on a lot of different ways. In fact, well, see if we can count how many different ways I could put the keys on the keychain. Pretty complicated problem because I have so many keys, and you know what we do with complicated problems. We make up easier problems, solve those. See if we can use that to solve the hard problems, so let's do that. Simpler problem would be less keys, so I'm going to take some keys off here. I'll hold on to them, so you'll still know I'm the boss. I'll take some of these off, though. It's kind of hard to take these keys off, and oh, who are we kidding? That's why the broken key is still on the keychain. Let's see, we're going to have to, well, here's what we'll do. We'll use a different keychain. Get rid of those. Here's our new keychain. Have a new keychain, we need new keys. There's two of our new keys. Green, orange. There's a red one. Let's see, oh, we got a couple more over here too. Got a yellow and a white key as well. And you see, these keys are much better than those other keys. For one, you can tell them all apart very easily. They're all different colors. Next, it's very easy to put them on the keychain. Just jab them right in, pull them right off. Very easy to put the keys on, take the keys off. That's nice. A lot nicer than the other keychain. But my favorite reason these keys are so much better than those other keys is these just plain taste better. Oh, yeah. Much better. So we take our five keys. Sorry about that. Hopefully we'll be able to get by with just four keys. In fact, you know what? We're going to start with three. I'm not going to eat this one because we might still need it. We'll start with three and hopefully we'll start with three and then go on to four and we'll have enough of a pattern to be able to solve the problem. So we're going to count the number of ways we can put these three keys on this keychain. We'll go ahead and write that down. We're going to start with three keys. And we'll start just by counting the number of ways that we can jam the keys on the keychain. One on the top, one over here, and one over here. Well, we have three choices for the one on the top. Just take one and put it in. That leaves two keys. So we have two options for which one to put on the side over here, leaving just one key to put over there. And there we go. So we're just going to throw the keys on the keychain, jam them in there. 3 times 2 times 1. Looks like we have 3 factorial ways to start with. But in that 3 factorial, we count this arrangement and this arrangement has 2 different arrangements. This 3 factorial will count each one of these as different. I'll also count this one. So it'll count each one of these 3 rotations as a different arrangement. But all 3 are the same. You can see that. I just spin one to get the next one. So they're all really just the same. So how do we deal with that? Well, we can deal with that the same way we did in the King Arthur problem. We divide. So this 3 factorial here counts this same arrangement 3 times. Once here, and once back here. So if we count it 3 times, we have to divide by 3 because we only want to count it once. So we take our 3 factorial and we divide by 3. Well, 3 factorial is 6. Divide that by 3, you get 2. So this is one arrangement. What's the other arrangement? Well, if we look at this, each of these rotations goes green, then white, then red when you go clockwise around the circle. It's a little confusing for me because from back here, when I go like this, green, white, red, for me back here, it's counterclockwise. But over here, when I'm you, that looks like clockwise to me. We call this foreshadowing. You'll see why in a minute. Each of these rotations goes green, white, red. Green, white, red when you go clockwise around the circle. So it looks like it's impossible to go green, red, white. See, each of these rotations, when we go clockwise, it's always green, white, red. Green, white, red. Looks like it's absolutely impossible to go green, red, white. So green, red, white must be the other arrangement. It must be the other completely different arrangement because we couldn't possibly get that by rotating the circle. So it's impossible. Or is it? Green, red, white. And now we see the difference between this problem and the King Arthur problem. See, King Arthur could rotate the table, but he couldn't flip it. Maybe Merlin could flip it, but King Arthur couldn't. But here we can flip our keychain. So when we start with just one arrangement, we can rotate it three ways and see that each of these three are really the same. They're also the same as their reflections. So we can just flip them over and see that these two are the same. So not only are these three rotations the same, but each of these three rotations is the same as its reflection. So instead of just these three rotations being the same, so that we're counting every arrangement three times, we're counting every arrangement three times two times. Three times for the rotations, and then times two, we have double it because each of these rotations can be flipped over. So the number of ways we can arrange these three keys, we start with our 3 factorial. That's going to count each arrangement 3 times 2 times. So if we count each arrangement of keys 3 times 2 times, we have to divide by 3 times 2 because we only want to count them once. And 3 factorial divided by 3 times 2, well, that's just 1. And there is only one way to arrange 3 keys on a key ring. So now we've tackled 3 keys, we're ready to move on to 4. All right, so go ahead and take this out, take this out. And we go grab our 4th key. So now I have 4 keys. We'll start the same way we did with 3 keys. We'll just throw the 4 keys on, one on the top, one on the side, one on the bottom, one on this side. So there are 4 ways to choose which key goes on top. Then there are 3 keys left to put over here. 2 keys left to choose from to put on the bottom. And then there's just 1 key left to go on the side. So we start with 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. That's 4 factorial ways to just stick the keys on there. So we'll start with 4 factorial. But of course, just as with the 3 keys, we're overcounting. Because that 4 factorial is going to count this and this as 2 different arrangements. It's also going to count this as a different arrangement, and it's going to count this as a different arrangement. So all 4 of these, it's going to count these as 4 different arrangements. We only want to count it once. But wait, there's more. In addition to each of these 4 rotations, it'll count each of the reflections of these rotations. So we have this rotation and its reflection. And we have this rotation and its reflection. This rotation and its reflection, and so on. So not only are we counting this arrangement 4 times once for each reflection, we're actually counting it 4 times 2 times. We've got the 4 rotations and then the reflection of each of those rotations. So if our 4 factorial counts each arrangement 4 times 2 times, well, if we want to know the total number of arrangements, all we have to do is divide by 4 times 2. 4 factorial is 24, 4 times 2 is 8, 24 divided by 8 is 3. And now we're ready to tackle the general problem. By general problem, I mean we're going to find a formula for how many ways I can arrange n keys on a keychain. And we'll use our simple cases as a guide. This is how we come up with most formulas in math. Dirty little secret. We start with simple cases, and we use them as a guide to find our formula. And we'll start same way we did with 3 and 4 keys. Imagine we had n keys. We start just jamming them onto our keychain. We'd have n factorial ways to just jam them on there. We have n ways to stick the first one on the top, n minus 1 ways to put the next one over, and so on. But that'll count each possible arrangement of keys a bunch of different times. In fact, it'll count it 2n times, because there'll be n rotations of that arrangement that you first got by putting all the keys on. And then for each one of those rotations, there's also its reflection. So you'll have the n rotation, and then two reflections for each of those rotations. That's 2n arrangements that are all the same. So you're counting that one arrangement 2n times when you start with n factorial. So you have to divide by 2n. Now, n factorial is just n times n minus 1 factorial. So we can cancel out the n's there, and we're left with n minus 1 factorial, and then we still have the 2 there. And there's our formula for n keys, or n minus 1 factorial divided by 2. And we can test it here for 4 keys. 4 minus 1 is 3, 3 factorial is 6, divided by 2 is 3. And this is a completely useless formula. Don't bother memorizing this. Now that you've seen how we come up with this, you can come up with this whenever you need it. Whenever you have a problem which you're counting the number of ways to arrange something that you can rotate and flip, you know how to deal with it. You have to divide by the n to account for the rotations. You divide by the 2 to deal with the reflections. And another reason you really don't want to bother just memorizing all these formulas is I can come up with all sorts of diabolical variations on this problem. All sorts of crazy little twists to the problem where all the memorizing of the formulas in the world isn't going to help you. But understanding the methods that we use to solve this problem will get you through pretty easily. We'll see some of those problems next, but right now, I'm going to take a break because that looks like lime. Oh yeah.